submitted. The next matter on calendar then would be Andreas Kogelnik versus Andreas Kogelnik, I guess. That's the way it's listed. That's 2260618. All right, thank you. So we have one person on video here, and I think that's Mr. Kleiner, unrelated to the other Mr. Kleiner. Is that right?
That's correct, Your Honor, yes.
Okay. All right, thank you. So it looks like, Mr. Kaplan, you're back up. You just got a brief sit down for that. So if you would then state your name and appearance again in this case. Thank you.
Your Honors, Gary Kaplan, Farella Brown Martell for the appellants Spark Factor Design and Working Dirt R2.
All right. You have 10 minutes total on this one.
Yeah, I'm planning to have 7 minutes initially, please.
Okay, thank you.
So first, there are some procedural issues that I think should be addressed quickly. I guess in an effort to avoid this court reaching the merits, the appellees interposed a number of procedural arguments saying that our objections to the original compromise should not be considered. And I wanted to just briefly address those because I think they're not correct. So first, the argument was that when we opposed this compromise, we failed to separately oppose it in this Kogelnik bankruptcy case, but in fact, we separately, it was a similar document, but in the one filed in this bankruptcy case, we expressly cited some reasons why the settlement or compromise that was proposed should not be approved in this case. And in particular, this is at the second volume of the excerpts of record at page 143. It says, there are several reasons this factor, and the factor is the so-called paramount interest of creditors and proper deference to the reasonable views, that's one of the so-called ANC property factors, should result in rejecting the motion to approve. And it goes on to say creditors are likely to be 84% of the debtor's bankruptcy claim pool, and they want this motion rejected. They do not want Kogelnik to waste assets in litigation with such a low chance of success. They do not want Kogelnik's estate to engage in litigation that could further delay Kogelnik's personal bankruptcy. These views are reasonable. So this is the crux of the argument we've made now at three courts.
So do you have any authority that a bankruptcy court may not approve a compromise agreement over the objection of the majority of creditors? Do you have any legal authority for that?
It's not that it may not approve it. It's that what the ANC Properties Court tells us and other authority from this circuit tells us is that those views should be carefully considered. It's not a must follow, but it's a strong direction that the court follow or listen to and the views of the majority of creditors. And I believe I'm trying to get you the exact site in our papers. Yes, so this is in the Transcon case, which actually is one the bankruptcy appellate panel relied on for its view that the majority of creditors should not be considered or not be necessarily be followed. That's at 764 Fed Second 1296. At 1299, it said, quote, the bankruptcy court and the trustee should carefully consider the wishes of a majority of the creditors. Well, the court did go on to note that those wishes are not binding. So the key is, yes, it's not a hard and fast rule, but if you follow this court's direction in the ANC properties, the standard is the paramount interest of creditors and the proper deference to their reasonable views in the premises. That's from page 1381 of this court's decision in ANC properties at 784 Fed Second. So the takeaway here is that the majority of creditors, their view sort of carries the most weight. It's not determinative, but it carries the most weight. And the lower courts essentially, I don't want to say ignored it, but failed to adhere to that and sort of brushed it aside on the grounds that there was personal interest involved. But there's no case law that says that you ignore the majority interest simply because those creditors would also benefit from one settlement versus another. There's no exception to this general rule to look at the majority of creditors.
So we're looking at abuse of discretion. So what arguments do you make that the bankruptcy court violated this standard in approving the compromise?
Well, I don't think the court what the court said was the only thing that is being given up is the ability to go after claims against the so-called Kogelnik parties. And that was the bankruptcy court's reasoning for why this was in the best interest of creditors. But that misstates what actually occurred. The bankruptcy estate really lost three things. They lost the $200,000 that the Kogelnik parties were willing to pay for this. They lost the expected litigation expense, which was estimated at $1 million. I can tell you right now it's going to be north of that in pursuing these claims. And they lost the ability to go after these valuable so-called OMI estate claims, which you heard about in the earlier case against the Kogelnik parties. So those three things need to be factored in trying to figure out whether this is a good deal, a fair deal for the creditors. And by just looking at one of them and saying, well, these claims don't seem to have a lot of value, even though the analysis is pretty thin, that's not enough. The court should have said, well, is this good money well spent? Is the $200,000 the Kogelnik estate is spending on this settlement and the $1 million expected litigation cost it's spending on this settlement a good use of money of the bankruptcy estate or not? And there was no real analysis done on that point, and that's really the key to why we think the approval should not have been granted.
So what if, hypothetically, if we found that the bankruptcy court erred in reopen medicine but not in this case? What is the appropriate remedy here?
Well, I think because the court, bankruptcy court, had one order that approved both compromises, if there's a reversal, that reversal is gone. And if one estate is not authorized to settle, in other words, let's say the OMI estate was not properly authorized to settle, then the settlement would go away, and therefore it really becomes moot whether the Kogelnik estate was properly or not properly authorized to settle. And we think that's the result that should happen. It should go back to the bankruptcy court and should be done what we would call correctly. I'm going to reserve my remaining time for rebuttal.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we're ready for Mr. Matthew Kleiner. Good morning.
Good morning, Your Honors. Matthew Kleiner on behalf of the appellee, Dr. Kogelnik. I plan to start my discussion today with a discussion of the proper standard of review, but Your Honor has already noticed or stated that the standard of review is abuse of discretion. And so I'll move directly to a point that I'd like to make. So this case is obviously much more narrow than the last case. And there's only one issue that's been raised, and that's whether or not the trustee and the bankruptcy court appropriately considered the interests of the creditors. What this appeal doesn't do is it doesn't address the other three factors in A and C. And under the abuse of discretion, the failure to address the other three factors prevents this court from doing a full analysis as to whether or not the A and C factors are met as a whole. Because unlike what the appellant's counsel was arguing as to the paramount interest of the creditors in that particular factor, there is no case law that says that is the most important factor there, that has to be satisfied in every case. To the contrary, the case law says that you have to consider all of the factors and then you weigh and consider the effect of all of the factors in making the determination if the compromise is negotiated in good faith.
Well, let me address you to something that kind of confuses me. The parties in the lower court inconsistently refer to basis as the buyer of the litigation claims or the Kogelnik entities collectively as the buyer, and the bankruptcy court refers to Kogelnik as the person paying $200,000 to the trustee. Doesn't that indicate we should view the parties collectively when considering if the $200,000 as well as the $1 million to fund the litigation is actually being taken away from the Kogelnik estate?
No, Your Honor. As part of the deal that was reached, basis, which is a separate entity owned by Kogelnik, which is, you know, not part of the bankruptcy. It's not part of this process. But Kogelnik is volunteering to use the funds that were raised and generated in a separate company to process and litigate claims against the targeted creditors or parties here in this case. Those funds would not be available, and there's been no showing that $1 million of funds would be available to the creditors in this case if they weren't being used to prosecute and assist the estate by pursuing these litigation claims.
So the bankruptcy court said that Kogelnik's analysis, I guess, what in the record supports the bankruptcy court's determination that Kogelnik's analysis of the likelihood of success in the litigation against the targeted parties was 50%. Where does that come up with? Is that just, what supports that?
Well, Your Honor, there's a lot of evidence that was submitted by the parties as it relates to the claims against each other. And I also would point out that that particular element was not raised in our brief. The only element of the ANC factors that was raised by the appellant in the brief is the paramount interest of the creditors. But ultimately, in the bankruptcy court and the trustee fully analyzed the likelihood of success of the claims against the OMI entity and concluded that it was a 50% chance. And as it compared to the claims that Kogelnik was going to bring, believed that based on the declarations and evidence that was submitted, that it was a higher percent of chance, 60% chance of winning on that particular claim.
So I asked your friend on the other side about if we find the bankruptcy court erred in the In Reopen Medicine, but not in this case, what's the appropriate remedy here? Can we affirm as to the bankruptcy analysis regarding the Kogelnik estate?
It's a good question, Your Honor, and I guess the cautious answer is it depends on what the ruling is. I know in listening to the last argument, there was a lot of discussion about the appropriate test, and that's not an issue that I profess to be knowledgeable about, and it wasn't part of our appeal. And I would defer to the other Mr. Kleiner, as to the arguments that were made as to which test would apply. However, if the court decides that the wrong test was applied, and there was some error in that regard, then I do think that the court did analyze both tests, and so I think that this court, even in finding that the wrong test may have been applied, and wanting to set forth maybe a rule going forward as to all cases, I think could apply the fact that this court did apply the 363 analysis. If the court is reversing on some other basis that would turn the settlement proposal that Kogelnik set forth on its head, then I think that these two cases are pretty intertwined in that context. And likely a reversal of the fairness, for example, of the underlying settlement agreement would put our agreement and our appeal at jeopardy in that context. So does that answer your question, Your Honor?
Yes.
So unless there are any other questions, I believe I've covered everything that I wanted to hit here today.
We don't have additional questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Your Honor.
Your friend on the other side does have some rebuttals, so stand by.
Thank you.
You don't get to say anything, but you get to listen. Thank you.
Yeah, Your Honor, Gary Kaplan again for the appellants. On one of the issues that counsel raised, and it was raised in their papers also, is that this court must affirm because only one of the ANC properties factors allegedly was not satisfied. But there's no case law or other support provided for this proposition. It's four factors, and the court's supposed to weigh each of them. And in fact, in the BAP's prior jurisprudence, just one factor not being satisfied was enough. In the Mickey Thompson case, and this is reported at 292 BR 415, and this is a quote from the bottom of page 420 and then top of page 421, it says, on this record, trustee has not met his burden of demonstrating that the compromise is fair and equitable. In particular, he has not shown how the settlement is in the paramount interest of creditors. And the paramount interest of creditors is quoted from this court's decision in ANC Properties. And it goes on to explain why that standard was not met. But that was the only factor from the ANC Properties analysis that is discussed in the opinion. That in and of itself was enough for the BAP to reverse the bankruptcy court's approval of a compromise. So just one factor, and it's the most important factor, what's in the best interest of creditors, is enough for reversal. You would also, I believe, raise the issue of where this 50-50 number or coin flip number came from, and we pointed out in our papers that that number appears to have been pulled out of thin air. There's no analysis that's given in any of any document. There certainly was no evidence below about 50-50 being the right number. And that's all I have, unless you have further questions.
I don't think we do. Thank you both for your argument in this case. This matter is submitted as well.